Continental champion of the world, Macho Man
nothing
Randy.
Means nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing
means nothing.
Man. Nothing means nothing. What do you mean by that?
War, I'm talking about all the way to the top, yeah. Unjustifiably in a position that I'd rather not be in. But the cream will rise to the top. Oh, yeah. Macho Madness, yeah, has got more to offer than President Jack Tunney thinks that I got. Yeah, and I'm going to tell you something right now. Cards stacked against the Macho Man Randy Savage in WrestleMania 3. Yeah, let me say it, yeah. Let me say it out loud. And let me point to the president of the World Wrestling Federation. The Macho Man Randy Savage is not happy with your decision, yeah. I am the cream in the World Wrestling Federation. And there is no doubt about it, yeah. You, Mean Gene Okerlund, you know that I'm the cream of the crop.
Oh, wait a minute, though, Randy. I've got to ask you very seriously. Do you blame Mr. Jack Tunney, the distinguished president of the World Wrestling Federation, for Ricky Steamboat being the Intercontinental Champion today?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. Outside interference, yeah. In my moment of glory. Yeah, no, I'm living in a nightmare. And I am the cream. And now, not only the Intercontinental Heavyweight Championship belt must fall, but the World Heavyweight Championship belt. Because Hulk Hogan, yeah, I am the cream, yeah. The cream of the crop. And there is no one that does it better than the Macho Man Randy Savage. On balance, off balance, doesn't matter. I'm better than you are, yeah. And I'm talking to everyone in the world.
Oh, man. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, happy. How long has it been since you've seen anything like that?
I don't know, but how about that improvisation with the little cream that fell off his head and he said unbalanced or unbalanced?
Dude, unbalanced, off balance, I'm better than you. You know, they just don't make TV like that anymore.
No, thank God.
Oh, man. Well, Mark, how are you, dude?
I'm awesome, man. Life's pretty good. How about you?
Dude, great. You've been crushing out there on your channel. I've been seeing you. You've been getting a lot of the same artists I have, man. Like, you've been doing great interviews.
Man, thank you. Yeah, I told you this a while back because I had you on too, which I appreciate. But I did not think it was going to be what it is.
And yeah.
It's just been so fun, man. I like, more than anything, I'm just kind of talking to my heroes.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah.
You know, and like tomorrow night, I have Gabe Dixon on. He's the keyboard player in Tedeschi Trucks Band.
Oh.
And I've never seen him play with Tedeschi Trucks. Like, I knew of him because he has a solo career. And
they want you to turn your mic up, Mark.
Oh, okay. Is that better? Yeah.
Perfect.
So, I've never seen him play with Tedeschi Trucks, but like, I knew him because I love the movie The Proposal. Like, I'm a huge Ryan Reynolds fan.
Mm-hmm.
And the opening track in that movie is Gabe Dixon. And I love that track. So I like went down a rabbit hole with him years ago. And then when I found out he was playing with Tedeschi Trucks, I was like, oh my God, yay. But he's killing, and he's like my first guest of this second season.
Yeah. Oh no, they're getting echo from you.
Dang.
We tried to figure this out. Well, anyway, for anybody that is not familiar with Mark, Mark's one of my friends here in Baltimore. He's one of my favorite guitar players here, and he is a huge Mo fan. And when I started going down the jam band rabbit hole here, he reached out to me and he was like, dude, do you ever do any Mo? Have you ever listened to any Mo? And I said, no. I mean, I think I've heard like Rebubula a couple times, but, or however you say that, but no. And he's like, well, dude, you gotta let me come on and show you some of these Mo tracks. And we've been trying to get it done for months.
Probably a year.
Yeah, right. Exactly. But I told you I wasn't going to do it without you. So tonight is the night.
Well, we're in for some. There's some long jams,
dude. So, I'm gonna let you lead here, but the link to Mark's channel is in the description. He does a bunch of great interviews and gear reviews, and he's a tremendous player. And for all you guys that are into like the Joey Landreth aerial posing, thing, Mark plays. What tuning you playing? Is it like open C sharp with 17s?
Well, I play in open C.
Open C.
But I also play in C standard. So yeah. Open C, it's 19 to 68. and C standard is 16 to 62.
Yeah. So anybody that's interested in that style, I highly recommend you watch Mark's channel and reach out to him. I know you do some lessons here or there because you're the man for that.
I'm going to be doing more of that stuff because people have been asking about it. People have been
Well, because who else does it? Who does it? And who does it? Who does it? Who does it? You know, a good job with it.
It's tough, man. I mean, I shedded on that stuff for years.
Yeah.
So I know you did. And it's still not where it needs to be, but you know,
nothing is fun. No. Yeah. So why don't we get started here? Again, Mods, good to see you. U.S. Elite Ski, good to have you back. I believe I modded your right name there. Fantasy, good to see you. Tom, beware. Fishing. Now, tell me about Mo. Tell me about, you know, wherever you want to start with the band and whatever track you want to start with. I am, you know, like I said, with the exception of maybe hearing Rebubula a time or two, this is ice cold for me, man.
Okay. And sorry about the echo, guys. We tried to figure it out, but couldn't troubleshoot it somehow. But just bear with me here. I'm going to do my best. So, 1997. Okay. It's the middle of summer, July-ish, 97. I'm at Virginia Beach Amphitheater. There to see Phish. Walking through the lot with my drummer. Some guy walks by with like a Mo shirt on. You know, the shirts that just say Mo dot. Mm-hmm. And we were like, what's that? And he was like, it's a band, man. They rock just as hard as Phish. It's like, okay. So when I got home, you know, this is like kind of pre-internet-ish. You know, there wasn't that much kind of information out there about bands and stuff.
97, oh, for sure.
Yeah. So I just like went to Record and Tape Traders and bought No Doi.
Yeah, Record and Tape Traders.
Yeah, that's what was there. So I bought that, and then I just fell in love because Chuck has like been one of my biggest like guitar influences since the 90s. So, you know, it's just that he plays the way that I hear guitar playing.
Yeah.
And then when I dug deeper down the rabbit hole, I found out that he's a huge fan of Wayne Krantz. And I was like, well, duh.
Yeah, I know Wayne's your guy.
Yeah. So I'm like, yeah. It makes absolute sense that I love this guitar player. So all my friends were still fishing, and I'm here turning into a moron. And I still love Phish and whatever, and I still, you know, I haven't seen them in a long time, but I still love the band. And Phish has been like a big influence too, but Chuck and Al, by far, one of my biggest influences.
They took you.
Yeah, and here's a quick aside. So I'm already a huge fan. I'm at the All Good Festival at Wilmer's Park in Maryland.
Oh.
I roll over.
Wait a minute. What year was All Good at Wilmer's Park?
Dude, it probably was 98, 99.
Yeah, because when did it move to Marvin's Mountaintop? And then it went somewhere else in West Virginia.
Yeah, probably anyway, early 2000s. But
I was told I was at a couple of them.
I mean, the funny thing about Wilmer's Park is that, I mean, it was like going to a show at a dump, you know, but like it's super fun.
Yeah.
But I, you know, the outskirts of the venue, there was a bunch of tents where bands had merch tents set up.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw Moe's, and I went over and I saw this shirt. I pulled this out of my like.
I love it, dude.
Hidden T-shirts for you, and then I bought this there.
The stuff you're hiding from your wife that she doesn't throw out. Oh my God, look at that shirt.
So I bought this shirt, and this is, dude. These are extra larges. What the hell was I thinking? I'm like a medium. I'm a schmedium at best. But so I was gonna buy the shirt because there was a person running the merch, and they're like, oh, maybe this guy will sign it for you. And Chuck turned around, and I was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And he was like, yeah, I'll sign it. And I was like, cool, man. And just like nerding out, telling him how he's a big influence, blah, blah, blah. And he does this picture. He drew this on my shirt.
Wow.
So it's Buster. That's from the song
it's
Buster.
It's time for my Prozac.
Yeah. So in this song,
dude, you
Akimbo,
are in it. I love this.
Dude, in the song Akimbo, he says, it's time for my Ritalin. But sometimes they would change the word. So I think it's time for my Prozac. He said that sometimes. So anyway, just kissing his ass for a while, talking to him. And then he's like, well, maybe, you know, this guy will sign it for you. And Al was there too. And I was like, holy crap, man. Hey, buddy. Like talking to him. And he's like, are you sure you want me to sign it? You love Chuck so much.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, dude. And this is what he wrote. Where is it? So Chuck's put, Chuck says relax. Because I was being a freak.
Yeah.
And then Al wrote, Al is number two.
Dude, I love this.
Yeah.
Kick mark.
Yeah, so I've had a huge relationship, and I was touring watching those guys to the point where they saw me in the audience. And like, I remember one moment in Wilmington, Delaware, I went to see them, and Al was ripping a solo, and I was like, ah, and he looked at me and was like, I can do it too, man.
Yeah.
And I was just like, you know, all right, all right. But dude, love
that
this
is,
guy.
That is so awesome. I had no idea that this was such a huge part of your life. I love this. Well, see, it's good that we waited then and did this together.
Yeah, dude, I mean, those dudes changed the way I played guitar. I mean, their guitar playing introduced me to modes and, like, understanding my neck, you know, kind of at a larger panoramic view.
Mm.
And then even writing and being in a jam band at that time, I understood how things are supposed to work and, like, so I started experimenting with putting songs together and finding spots that have jams and bringing a chorus back. Or they were my education. Mm. So anyway, that's my short yet
dude,
long.
Dude, let's
story.
Do it. Well, where do you want to start? Let me hear some.
So let's go back to always one of my favorite songs to hear live was Timmy Tucker. So let's start there.
Okay, and if you hit the full screen on YouTube, it'll just full screen this. It won't actually take over your whole screen.
Oh, you want me to hit it?
Yeah.
Okay.
See how we can still see each other?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Technology.
It only took me 6 months to figure that one out. All right, go ahead and play it anywhere you want, man.
All right.
Just a job, but that's all the time. Timmy gets a
foot faring on. Couldn't even go on the grenade right off. Himself a short track down the American ACL. No election. Thank you, Mariah. Agreed, fans. Buffalo, huh?
I think Chuck was like one of the first guitarists that I started buying pedals because he used them.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And I bought my Klon. I don't any more time. I sold it. That's how I bought my sir.
That's a super tight band. Here, let me bring this down here. Let me pull you up here. So, a couple things. One, I can totally hear a lot of that in your playing. That's a very tight band, man. I was grooving hard in that.
I mean, the thing about it is, what's funny is, Mo gets this rap because they're not as like precise. And I know some people are hearing an echo if you just got here. We tried to work it out.
I think it's just on your mic, not on the music, though.
I turned the mic off.
When the music was playing?
Yeah. Okay. I didn't want to screw with that.
Yeah.
So, they don't get this, you know, Umphrey's is precise and visceral.
By the way, yes, Mark, you're going to come to the barn and we're going to play soon.
Oh, hell yeah.
That's going to happen. All right, keep going. Sure.
And I know I don't have a Klon anymore. I said that I sold it to buy this guitar. So I no longer have a Klon Centaur because I bought it for $300 in 2002, and I sold it in 2013 for $1,500.
That's so bananas. It's so bananas.
It's dumb. But what was I saying? Oh, so Mo kind of gets this like working man's jam band type of a reputation, which is, you know, fine. I think that's what I like about them is that they're rough around the edges. And they don't take themselves too serious. They are. Yeah. I mean, if you listen to some live stuff, I have tapes. I have like a case of Mo live tapes.
I love this.
Yeah. My daughter was just going through them this weekend because she just figured out what tapes are. Mm-hmm. So it's like
my kids have no idea what tapes are.
Oh yeah. It's a whole thing right now with her. She's like, you made mixtapes, and like, I'm showing her and stuff. But, yeah,
thank you, Plectrumura.
They do get a, kind of like, they're not as good as Fish or not as good as Umphrey's. I'm like, it's not a competition, man. It's what you enjoy, you know? It's like,
for sure,
run with it, you know? But I love them, man. And I'm ever since you started, you kind of got me back into like jam band stuff because I shunned it for a while because I think my guitar playing was suffering because I was noodling too much.
Wait, you mean you were noodling when you were on the jam scene too much and you chose to kind of move on because you wanted whatever you wanted?
Yeah, I wanted to be a better guitar player in the sense that I wanted to have more vocabulary.
Right.
And I was resting too much on my jam band laurels. So I put it out of my life for a while.
That's interesting. Sander Mosk, thank you so much. yeah, I mean, obviously I came in at it from a completely different perspective, you know, from a, you know, a non-improvised anything kind of world, you know, and so for me, it's very much the opposite. I find myself not noodling much in this music. I find myself really focused on, you know, what are the melodies that connect the chords and what are all these things that I have been missing since I spent the first 20 years of my life only caring about riffs and you know, sending lightning strikes to the back of the room, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's weird.
It's funny.
It's a weird road to travel because that music got me so much into understanding my instrument better, but that it also closed off my world a little bit.
I think that's true with any genre.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and that's when I got really big into Wayne Krantz, like right before I went to Berkeley. You know, mm-hmm. I 2005. It's probably when I started getting into, like, you know, Wayne. And actually, like, in that time, I put out a record that was, like, pop music.
Yeah.
Back in, like, 2000, when I quit my band, I had a band called Tribe of Ben that did really well for a long time. Like, selling out the record theater kind of well. Like, we did really well.
That's great, dude.
And then we broke up.
I missed the record.
I know. It's coming back.
Well.
Kind of. But when I left that band, I was like, I was listening to Ben Folds and I was listening to the Beatles way more than I ever had and listening to Wings and all this stuff that really kind of, because I was playing a lot more piano.
Mm-hmm.
So I was pushing myself on that instrument. Maybe that was another catalyst to moving me away from it because I was playing so much piano too at the time. But I was so happy when you started doing Dead stuff because like that's my youth, man. My older siblings, I was raised on the Dead and Fish.
Yeah.
You know, so it's nice. It feels like I'm coming home. You know?
No, dude, it's great. It's I'm always endlessly fascinated. I'm endlessly fascinated about how age, the people around you at the different ages, and the things that happen to you, you know, and how that is connected with the musical landscape and how you traverse that. Because different people can get into different genres for different reasons at different times in their lives, and it's not always just one thing. And I find it so fascinating. I mean, I know you saw it at Berkeley too, but when I was at GIT, I saw so many people who came in as a fill-in-the-blank player and left as a fill-in-the-blank player. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And they were like completely different things. And it's just, you know, if you had older siblings that got you started on this stuff, that's what you were listening to. I did not come from a musical family. I didn't have anybody that showed me anything. So I was very much a kid of, you know, what was on the radio in the early 90s, you know, the Nirvana grunge thing, and then that just turned into metal for a decade or so. And it just, and that's what happened. I didn't have someone guiding me saying, dude, check this out, check this out. I didn't have an older brother like that. That's cool.
My brother didn't show me shit.
He just had it laying around.
I was just in the other room listening. I mean, I wasn't allowed in my brother's room most of the time, you know? So it's like, he would sit and play FIFA in front of his little TV listening to Dead Tapes, and I would be like totally enamored. Because at the same time, like, just like you, man, I started playing guitar because I heard Pearl Jam and, you know, all those Seattle bands.
Yeah.
So I made my way to the Dead through Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, Nirvana, Pantera. Like,
yeah.
It was a weird road.
Yeah. I love that, though. I'm endlessly fascinated about that. And, you know, I feel like when I was younger, I think we all feel this way, but we all kind of deeply know that, like, the people who are really, really, truly, exceptionally great at one genre pretty much stay in that genre, you know? Was it master of none, but, you know, you're good at everything.
Jack of all, master of none.
Yeah, it's either that or it's like you're like, or it's like you're Stevie Ray Vaughan, and you do Stevie Ray Vaughan, and that's who you are, you know? Mm-hmm. And before I went to GIT and really started, expanding my musical mind, I was just like, this is what I'm going to do, and I didn't try to get into anything else. And that hindered me for a long time.
Yeah, I can see that. Even right now, like, I'm rediscovering my love for Mike Doty. Do you ever listen to Mike Doty?
I don't know who Mike Doty is.
You know who Soul Coughing is?
I know of the band. I can't name a song right now.
So Mike Doty's lead singer, Soul Coughing, and then he went off and has a solo career. He's still playing, but he has this record called Haughty Melodic that I forgot how much I loved that album until 2 days ago. And every night when I'm cooking dinner now, cranking the hell out of that record. And my wife's dancing, my kid's dancing. Like, my wife's like, oh my God, I forgot about this album. You know, so there's... I listen to so much stuff. I think we both do. Like, so much music. And if I didn't have the luxury of actually appreciating all of it, I would lose my mind. Because if I was stuck in one zone just listening to blues music or whatever, like, that wouldn't satiate my soul completely.
No, definitely not. But I do think a lot of it is a function of maturity and exposure to different things and other people that you like and trust and respect turning you on to things. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, still to this day, I mean, I have so many friends that, especially ones that I met in GIT, who, you know, they were just on the sweet picking shred metal thing. And 20 years later, what are they on? The sweet picking shred metal thing. And they are going to die trying to be the fastest, cleanest sweeper that ever lived.
Yep.
And that is, they have dedicated themselves to it. They do hours of metronome work every day, and that is it. Mm-hmm. You know, and I was victim to that for a long time. But yeah, now I listen to all kinds of shit. I love
it. Hey man, I rented the Frank Gambale Hot Licks VHS. I wanted to learn what he was doing, but I don't use that stuff. I mean, it's just... This is for fun.
Well, on that note, let's listen to another one. By the way, I see all the super chats coming in. Thank you so much. You guys know I always split all my donations with my guests. And tonight, if you want Mark to play something, if you have a track, if he opens it up, that's up to Mark. If you have any questions for Mark, please go ahead and ask. If he sees someone he likes, he can jump on it. And don't forget, the link to his channel is in the description. So please do me a personal favor and think about going over there and subbing to him.
Oh, thanks, buddy.
He's almost at 1,000, so let's get him over.
Like 45 away or 42 away now. So I'll have to talk to you about that because I have no clue what's going to happen after that happens, like as far as monetization and all that crap.
I think you have to get to 10K for monetization.
Oh, do you now?
Okay. I don't know.
It used to be 1K back in the day. I'm not even worried about that. I'm just having fun.
Especially with what I do when I play other people's music, it basically all gets demonetized. Yeah. And so it's it I make a living for people that choose to be my student at GuitarGate. The YouTube money is not very significant.
Yeah, I'm not even worried about that. I'm just having a good
time. Just have a good time and be yourself. Don't even worry about making money.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Let's do the next one I have in here is actually a song called Bullet,
mm-hmm.
but it was originally entitled Ass Finger. And I know the story behind it a little bit. Apparently it had something to do with a roadie and a one night stand.
Gotcha. Before we do that, Pete has a request for you. I don't know if you know that track. So we'll put that on the back burner.
Yeah, let's do that one. I almost put Plane Crash in here, but I thought that was too obvious, but that track jams.
All right. So remember that one.
Okay. Plane Crash, 2013.
Thank you, PL. Thank you, Pete.
Cool. Let's. So this one is from this past summer. They must have gotten together in a barn in Utica.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, just started, put a concert together kind of thing. But let me get this.
You make that full screen.
Yep. All right, here we go.
Let's do it.
Tracks off of Wormwood.
It's got a really interesting feel to it. Yeah, Ronald Suspicious. That's right, it sounds suspicious.
Chuck is playing Strats again, because that last track he was playing a Dennis Fano guitar before Dennis moved to create Novo guitars.
Gotcha. That's correct.
Chuck has all the toys too, man. All the rotary stuff.
I'm hearing this.
Yeah.
I hear where you got it from. Love this space.
We'll be right back.
Yeah, Ronald, I love the harmony. Dig that America, that Maryland flag guitar. Whoa, what was that?
Chuck has this great way of this is like angular attack. Yeah. Improvisation. I just love it.
Exactly right, Brandon. Definitely feeling it. We'll be right back. I love this bass part. Really good. I'm aware of that. Dude, there was so much going on in there. But that was such a build. I love that bass player.
Yeah, man.
Dude, there's so many parts where like he and the keys are like doing it's like unison, but then it breaks off, and then it's unison, and then it breaks off, and and there's just so many like sporadic parts. You can hear like, each one's like, like that sounded huge.
That's my favorite Mo song.
Yeah, that there were tons of that in the comments that like, dude, that was the best Mo ever.
It's just a, from start to finish, there's like so many cool, even though like the verse section is just repeating the whole time, like, we are waiting. Like, there's so much depth to what's going on. Like, even if you listen to like the guitar part over the verse section, it's kind of intricate. And then when you listen to the chorus section, it's super simple. I mean, it's a simple tune in general.
Yeah.
But it's like, there's so many layers to the onion, man. It, I don't know. It's cool. I love that song.
Dude, no, it was super cool. I totally dug that. And you know, I love that room too. That must have sounded amazing in there.
Yeah, it looks cool.
It does look cool. I'm trying to figure out whether I should assemble instruments in a circle or have them in a line. I'll probably go back and forth.
Oh, you mean when you do your videos?
Yeah. So I'm gonna. So what I'm gonna do is. So I have I posted that post, and then I have a family friend reach out to me. And it's like, hey, I have this party barn that, you know, no one can have parties anymore. And you know, if you want it, use it. And I'm like, are you kidding me? And they're like, yeah, just use it. I was like, can I leave my stuff there all set up? And they're like, yeah, just go for it. No one's going to be in there for 6 months at least, maybe a year, or do whatever you want. And so I have drums. I have a PA. I have, you know, amps and et cetera, et cetera. So I want to, like, set it up and have people over and do concerts. I want to write tunes. I want to make a lot of noise. I mean, why not?
Yeah,
you know?
Man.
But I'm also going to, you know, move my desk and my cameras and stuff over there. So I'm still going to do these, but I think like with everything set up in the background and get out of my house.
Yeah, dude. That sounds, you know, great.
Yeah. You should because the kids aren't going back to school.
Yeah, yeah. You know what we were going to do right before this crap all went down?
What?
So we do this version of Blackbird. That's like a second line kind of New Orleans-y feel thing. We were going to go somewhere like a barn or like a studio and set up in a circle, kind of like the Wolfpack thing.
Yeah.
And get two camera people back to back and just, you know,
yeah,
around in a circle just to kind of catch the whole band and do a one take kind of thing like Wolfpack.
Yeah.
Would do. That stuff's always interesting. I love watching stuff like that.
Oh, totally. And just like, you know, anything to get back together and play with people, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, dude. Anyhow.
Yeah.
Anyhow, let's see what I saw something I wanted to.
Do you want to pull up that plane crash on your end? Or?
Yeah, sure. We can do that. Also, Matt Story asks, a lot of Umphrey's fans here, if you've seen Umphrey cover Rebubula.
I have.
Yeah, I'm sure they do a good job.
Oh, yeah, they do a good job. Yeah,
I'm sure they very do a good job. All right, yeah. Tell me, actually, you do it because I already forgot what to search for.
It was plane crash from 2013, right?
I think so. Yeah, plane crash. Yeah, fantasy, you're right. We haven't seen any Wolfpack on this channel in a while. I know. I know.
Do that too, man, all day.
Dude, it's how easy is it to listen to Wolfpack?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, all right. They want to hear plane crash. Let me pull this up here.
Is it from summer camp? I think that's what it was.
I can pull up the super chat. It's just going to take me a minute. But you know what? Just hit it. Yeah, it was the summer camp with Ali.
This tracker is amazing.
Oh God, commercials.
Oh, look at you. You don't have YouTube Premium?
No, I'm a lame-o.
Oh God. Oh, you can't go back. Well, hold on 1 second. Press pause real quick.
Yep.
So, yeah, I had to do YouTube Premium. Well, one, I listen to my music that way anyway. But two, that way you don't get ads in the middle of videos, because now all the ads are going in the middle.
I've noticed that.
Oh.
That's some horse donkey.
Oh my God, dude. Well, they're doing it, obviously, to make more money. And I get so many comments. I'm glad you guys are listening. You can hear this from me. I get so many comments from people that just like, oh, he's just putting ads in the middle of his video. If you see ads in the middle of one of my videos, it means it got demonetized. You don't get to choose where the ads go or what they are if you don't have the rights to that video. So if you see ads in any one of my videos, it's because it got demonetized and that rights holder is getting the money and I can't do anything about it. Oh, so, sure. Yeah. But anyway, so I had to do premium so I didn't have my... That happened in the middle of videos all the time.
I'll check it out. That's worth a check out. So,
all right. Go for it, sir.
All right. Let's do this thing. This is such a good song.
Yeah, I know you are, Chris. Vibrato.
Yeah, her tone is ridiculous.
Thank you, Andy. Yes.
All right, you should probably play it.
For her. She's okay. Now.
We also made sorry, guys. Party foul on my part.
See, this is live.
That's so lame, too. That was only like a minute and a half.
Oh, dude. And they say, we'll do it at the natural breakpoints.
Nope.
Yeah.
And sorry,
like,
guys.
I was like, come on. I do not want the quarter of a penny for that. I just want the music to not stop. Okay. What am I doing? All right, new window. Bear with me, ladies and gentlemen. All right, tell me what I'm searching for again.
Mo, plane crash, 2013, summer camp.
Got it. Okay.
I'm going to say five Hail Marys tonight because of that
happening. How many minutes were we in there? One?
Yeah, about one. One and a half. I'm not even Catholic, but I'll say some Hail Marys tonight because of that.
Do it.
It's my fault. Yeah, that's good.
James.
Her tone is so good.
That's right. Keep practicing. It's coming. You have a deal devoted to Mariah. You have a deal. That's a good idea. Yeah, man. Grooving.
It's a good tune, man.
Yeah. We're going to bring it. Well, shoot. Oh, didn't mean to do that.
What happened?
Are you back?
I'm here.
I almost dumped you. Sorry about that. Yeah, Tom. The joy on stage. You could see that. That was coming through big time.
Man. You know what's funny? I was thinking while that was playing, I was thinking about all the shows that I've been to, and I saw a couple of people say they've been to like 100 shows, which I have not. I probably have been to 50, but not 100. But
50's a lot, dude.
Yeah, dude, you don't understand, man. I had hair down to here. I wore Birkenstocks with wool socks on them in the wintertime.
No, you didn't.
Oh, yes, I did.
No, you didn't.
It was terrible. I rode my skateboard to class in college. No, it's funny to think about...
Wait, you rode your skateboard with Birkenstocks and wool socks up in Boston?
No. This is when I was at Salisbury. Berkeley's my second degree.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah. But I was thinking about all the shows that I've been to, and I remember they were supposed to play at the Wrecker Theater one time, and something happened. They either oversold capacity or whatever. And do you remember, like, the Bow Dome downtown? Bo Hager's Dome. There was like a dome that they put up.
Yeah. Oh, man, you're bringing it back.
Dude, my girlfriend at the time, her uncle was somehow connected to that place. And Mo had to move the show from the record to there. And so she got us like VIP in there and stuff. And that was right when Tin Cans and Car Tires came out, which is one of my favorite records of theirs as well. Like, my favorite records of Mo are probably Tin Cans and Car Tires and Wormwood. Uh-huh. And Dither a little bit, but mostly the Wormwood and Tin Cans. And the show, I was like right up front, and like, I just think about all these different gigs I've been to. I went to a New Year's gig in Asbury Park where Chuck was sick, throwing up in a bucket on the side of the stage. And like, just stuff like that where things come back to you. You know what I mean? Like, it's just,
yes.
There's this, I'll never forget those things. And I'll never forget putting my middle fingers up to them, because I felt like they had it out for me, because I hated every time they covered Godzilla.
And they always did it when you were there? They played
it every damn time I would show up to a show. And I was like, I think they're trying to make me not come see them anymore. And they encored, I think, with Godzilla at Asbury Park on New Year's Eve. And I just remember throwing my middle fingers up and leaving. I was like, screw this band. And then when I left, I got outside and I was like, damn it. And I ran back in because all my friends were still there. But like stuff like that. And was anybody else at the Dark Side of the Mo show in Philly where they covered Dark Side of the Moon?
Oh, I bet that was cool. What year was that?
Oh, 2001, 2000, something like that. And then they did a Willy Wonka thing in New York. I was there for that. One Halloween. I don't know. They always do like a movie theme kind of thing or something weird for Halloween.
Yeah.
But so many good memories, dude.
Yeah.
I've seen that band. So many good memories.
Love
anyway.
It.
Anyway.
Well, anybody have any questions for Mark? Mark, I know you got a couple other tracks. I'm not trying to keep you too late, but anybody got any? They always tease Godzilla. What about Joy Division? Jesus, what a I saw the Primus Willy Wonka show.
Yeah,
well, that seems crazy. That seems crazy.
That's awesome.
Oh, let's see here. Thank you all for sticking around and doing this little listening party here. This is cool. Well, I'll keep an eye out for some questions here. What else do you have queued up back there?
I have a video that is just Al side, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a rad version of a song. So let me back up here. Woo, sorry guys. Here it is.
Of course, Mark likes Chris Cornell.
All dang day. His new cover, that new cover album that they put out. I mean, he made me like the song Patience. I used to hate that song, but his version of Patience is so good.
Yeah.
I've seen the
what it's all about, man. Different time feels in here. Swimming at men, looking towards palace, fading in such. I was out of place now. Just to drive around in my car, anytime there's an end part game, to sing the harmony with.
That's okay though.
I love it. User, oh god, where the hell did it go? Damn it. User Ambit says your new album is awesome. Dude, are you in Baltimore, user? Mark, for everybody that doesn't know, Mark, you do have a recent album that just came out and it is awesome.
Thanks, man. It came out last November, but I mean it's you know, a year and recent. A couple months. Yeah. And Joey Landreth played on it.
Yeah. So I know. It's awesome.
Thanks, man. Yeah, no, I'm writing a bunch of new stuff. I have some.
You have links to all that in your YouTube descriptions and or on your channel if people just click over to there.
I don't, but I should do that. See, that's where my game needs to be leveled up. But my record's on like Bandcamp and Spotify and stuff. If you just look up Mark Hopkins and the Pretty War, it's on there.
Got it. Mark Hopkins and the Pretty War. Let's see. Cody's stressed out about how high he's playing up the neck on that tune.
Yeah, me too, man. Isn't that funny? Like, I never really thought about that, but, like, anytime I get up to, like, you know, the 17th fret or whatnot, my fat fingers start to freak out a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like there's different zones on the guitar. Like, every time I enter them, I'm just like, okay, I can only be here for a second. I can't live here very long.
Yeah.
You know?
You can't like, start just... there because then you just blew your whole wad. You got to start there. Work your way to it, you know?
Yeah, ooh. although I'm a huge fan of doing big, strange leads just here, like, on the low strings for, like, you know, big bends and things like that, like, super low, but I don't feel that way about super high usually.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's funny. Yeah, no, I mean, I'm such a mid-range guy. I mean, since I play a lot of slide, I hang out up high sometimes, too.
Oh,
so.
I mean, it certainly sounds better. It certainly... fits better in the mix, but
cuts hard. That's
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, for sure. On that note, I don't know if you have your guitar plugged in or handy or any of that stuff, is there anything in particular that comes to mind? Like if someone were, is watching and they're just like, what's like one like key takeaway or thing I should, that he really did that you like to show people, or that really like, you're just like, this is really like a thing that I got from this.
Let me see real quick. I could turn on this new Magnetone amp that's on loan.
There you go.
So I think what kind of like made me pumped about Mo was the whole, like when I was talking about learning my modes. So yeah. For instance, one of their tunes, like Spine of a Dog, Into Buster, things like that, where they're like, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So if the jam is over that, like realizing that I can play only in G major and I can go all over the fretboard.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So like for me, that was a revelatory moment, knowing that this is the 5 chord and the 4 chord, but the 1 is actually there.
Yeah.
So like in that groove, stuff like that, that I could kind of practice by myself,
mm-hmm.
and I could practice my phrasing, so I'm being more lyrical instead of just like spitting notes, like, you know
yep,
what I mean?
Yep, yep.
So for me, that was the thing that Mo taught me. So when I started writing songs and learning how to play over a vamp, it made it way easier that I could do, you know, I could mix my blues stuff. So what Chuck does really great is if he's playing in this world, he'll do that, but he'll go.
Yeah. Yeah, I noticed so, a few of those, yeah.
Yeah, and the other thing that I really learned is he uses the 9 all the time,
mm-hmm.
but he'll bend to it. So
from the root?
He'll do that for like tension.
Uh-huh.
So
I love doing that.
You know what I mean? He'll do stuff like that. And like quick, stabby bends.
Yeah.
And he does something that Wayne Krantz does, where Wayne will do like.
Yeah, yep.
You know? So that, I learned that stuff from him, but I also learned using that 9 is also something that you hear Stevie do, so. You know?
Yep.
And that's like a Mike Landau thing too. Mike Landau will go. Stuff like that. And Chuck has all of that in his vocabulary. And then also, too, not only utilizing this whole G major world that we would live in that, but then understanding that that is just, that's a fragment of what you can do in terms of, like, creating tension and all that. So I hear Chuck do things where he would go, you know, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And he'll, there's one of their songs, oh man, was it, you know, stuff like that, like, where you're kind of playing outside just a little bit. Not, it's not like you're playing a, like you're not playing a whole tone scale or anything weird. You know, it's nothing like that. It's more musical in a sense.
Yeah.
So, you know, if I'm playing in D minor, just being a little bit more flavorful with lyrical playing, I guess. That's what Chuck taught me.
Yeah.
Instead of just, you know, stuff like that all day long.
Yeah, yeah.
So, oh, 4, yeah. Somebody was just asking. That's another Mo song.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the main thing. Like, I mean, I didn't know much about it. I knew how to get around on the neck, but I didn't know what I was doing was actual modal.
Yeah.
Or playing using a major scale instead of like a sitting on like a minor vamp. Like John Scofield has always been huge for me. Like being able to take one chord. And like play, you know, just outside.
Yeah.
But still be able to use your pentatonic scale and whatnot.
Yeah.
It's kind of all led me here, you know, with so how I play.
So when you so when you were real big into Mo, this is when you were in Salisbury, right? This was pre-Berkeley.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. And so then. So they started kind of turning you on to this kind of modal thing and being more lyrical. And then what made you take the jump to actually go to Berkeley? And how do you view where you were as a player when you got there?
I mean, the whole reason I applied there was on a whim. I was teaching.
I love it.
I was teaching.
Me too, man.
Yeah, I was teaching music at Boys Latin. And my wife was finishing up grad school, and she applied to doctorate programs at Boston College.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, what the hell am I going to do? Okay, I'm down with moving to Boston because, like, I grew up a Celtics fan. And, you know, I'm an Orioles fan, but I'm also a Red Sox fan, weird enough. But, like, because that's because of my older brother. He was, so I was.
Yeah.
And I applied. She didn't get in, unfortunately, but I got a bunch of money thrown at me. And I was like, we can go or we cannot go. I'm okay. Yeah. With either way you want to do it, babe. And she was like, let's go. Let's have an adventure, man. Screw it.
Yeah.
And so we went, man. And I only went for 2 years. And I was in the songwriting program, and I did everything in the songwriting program that I could. And then I bounced. But then I ended up finishing my degree since then.
Hmm.
Through like remote classes and stuff, because I work for Berkeley.
Yeah, I know that. I didn't know if you were gonna look. Yeah. I actually have a picky left here. The Berkeley
that
online
fell
thing.
Out of my case.
Yeah,
I don't use big old guys like that. I use those jazz threes.
Oh yeah, I don't know where it came from, but I would never have this.
It's a big old potato chip.
Oh yeah,
these.
It is. Yeah. Yeah. It is.
But, you know, man, it's just, man, life is so fun.
Thanks, Timothy.
Yeah,
yeah, man, it totally is. Have I told you the story about how I went to GIT?
Mm-hmm.
This is a funny story. can be very, very, very seat of the pants. And just when I get something in my head, I just go and do it. And I just refuse to not do things that I think that I should do. There's a word for that that's escaping me, but it's bigger than stubborn. It's stubborn with passion squared.
Impulsively fun.
It's impulse is certainly one of them. Anyhow, so I was in school in Charleston, South Carolina, and for business or something that is meaningless. At some point, because you know, my family wanted me to work with them and do whatever, and I basically just got to a place where I was like, you know what, screw it. Like, I need to find out if I'm good enough to play guitar for my life. Otherwise, I'm not gonna do anything. You know, I'm gonna be doing what everybody does and just doing whatever. Because I don't know if you know this about me much, but I never really played guitar for anybody. Ever. It was always 100% private thing for me.
I remember saying that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I still, you know, it was an absolute escape and release for me. But I also knew that it came very naturally, at least the rhythm and dynamic part of it, not the harmony and melody. But anyway, I really felt that I was a strong player. And I was just like, you know what, screw it. I'm leaving school. I'm leaving Charleston. I'm leaving, you know, that whole wonderful life. And I'm just going to California. And I just packed my car and went to California with no real plan. And I had a friend that lived out there that went to Cal Arts, the school Walt Disney founded up there in the desert, and stayed with him a couple weeks. And he lived off Hollywood Boulevard. And so I was walking down Hollywood Boulevard and didn't even know that GIT existed or was a school. And I walked in and I walked in the door because they had their live playing workshops where you play outside. And I heard bands playing. I saw it was a school and I walked in the door and I was like, what the hell is this place? And they kind of gave me a tour and I was like, okay, I want to go here. What do I have to do? And they were like, well, it starts in like the next semester starts in 2 weeks. It's 10 weeks on, 2 weeks off till you graduate. And I was like, so you're saying it's about to be over and the next one starts in 2 weeks. They're like, yeah. They're like, well, what do I have to do? It's like, well, you have to apply. You got to do all this stuff. You got to do that. And I was like, can I do it right now? And they were like, what do you mean can you do it right now? I was like, can you do it right now? And so they said, you got to come back in a day or two. They came back. They put me in a room with, it wasn't Dan Gilbert. It was Stuart Ziff. It was somebody. And one
Dude.
Of their...
Really quick aside.
Yeah.
I know Stuart Ziff.
Do you?
He is finishing his degree online with Berkeley right now. He's one of my students. I talk to him all the time.
Dude.
He is an awesome guy.
He is an awesome guy.
Yeah.
So anyway, you have to remember at this point in time, I was probably 23 at this time. And I've been playing since I was 5 or 6 years old, but never learned any theory, never learned any harmony, never learned to read, barely ever really learned songs. They basically just worked on chops for 15 years starting as a child. And so I went into the room with the guy, and he's like, play me a G major scale. I said, dude, I don't know how to play a G major scale. He's like, well, you got to be able to play all these different modes and different octaves, you know, at least 2 octaves to pass this first entrance exam. And I was like, well, you play them for me and I'll play them back to you. You know what I mean? And so he did that and played and bled back to me. And he was like, okay, they might be able to let you in. But like, I didn't know anything. Long story short, I went home. Convinced my parents to support me in this endeavor, and went back in 2 weeks and started. It was completely serendipity. I did not have it planned out. I just decided I wanted to go there, did what I had to do, made it happen, and made it through.
Man, that's awesome, dude. I had no clue.
Yeah. That's kind of the story of my life, you know, like I find something that works and I do that, and then I find things that don't work and I don't do those anymore. You know,
it's
and
pretty
I just
logical
keep,
to me,
just,
man.
Just kind of keep going. But yeah, I mean, when I went to GIT, I mean, I didn't know any music theory. I didn't know any. I couldn't write. I couldn't read. I mean, literally none of it. And they let me in by the skin of my teeth, and I've just been forever grateful.
Man, that's awesome, dude.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got one chance on this planet, right?
That's it.
That's all I mean, as far as we know. And,
yeah.
I feel like you got to take risks sometimes to live, to feel alive.
You have to, man. And I had that moment when I was in college, and I was like, if I don't cancel everyone else's plans right now for me and try to do what I know that I was born to do since I was a little kid, things are not going to work out for me. And it's those little decisions to turn the key to go and then to do everything it took to get accepted when I was way underqualified, you know what I mean? Or at least didn't have, I mean, they basically just let me in because they knew I wasn't going to leave and they knew I had real chops. But then those little tiny wins started building confidence over the years, you know what I mean? And that, of course, has snowballed into teaching and other things. But it all really started that moment. I feel like so many people do find that moment. They find themselves at that place sometimes in their life where they feel like, you know, this is the time to jump or not. And I'm so happy that I did and continue to whenever I get the opportunity.
I am too, because we would never have met.
It's true.
Point blank, even though we live 20 minutes from each other.
Dude, it's so ridiculous. Yeah, we live 20 minutes from each other. You work for Berkeley. It's nuts.
And we've talked about this too. Is like, for years now, we've been like, oh, we'll get together, we'll get the kids together, we'll hang out, blah blah blah, and then this crap all happened.
Dude, it's nuts, but I can't wait till we can play. I'd love to play some shows. I would love to have you over and actually play on the channel, and do all those things. Just COVID, man, COVID.
And, you know, there's a light at the end of the tunnel right now, man. So it's like, we all got to just hunker down for a little bit longer.
Yeah.
And I think things are going to start to come back. And, like, I saw a bunch of people in the chat posting saying, it's going to come back, music's coming back. And
yeah.
And I believe that, too. And it may be different for the first, you know, season of music. But it's going to be all right, man.
I agree. Okay, why don't you take us out? You got one more for us? And then we'll call it an evening. You got, unless you see any questions or anything.
I do, but you know what's funny is I have Rebubula, and I don't want to do that.
I have heard that. So
yeah, so let's not do that. Does anybody have something they really want to hear? I would love to hear something new. If there's any new, oh, you know what? There's a really good song. There's another good Chuck song.
Spine Buster.
Let's do somebody, you know, something that somebody suggests.
Yeah, you seemed very excited. You seemed excited. I want to know.
Well, let me see here. This song is so cool. I don't know though. Here's the thing: is like, this is at Red Rocks. You might want to do it because I'm afraid there's going to be ads.
Mo Wind It Up from Red Rocks from 18.
Yeah.
See if you get any pushback from the people.
Yeah, and I'm open. So, because Matt's saying She Sends Me, if that's a good version of She Sends Me, that's a great tune too. So, Mother Love Bone. Oh yeah, I'm right there with you.
Doing this.
Yeah, let's at least listen to the first minute or two because it's a cool tune.
Let's do it. Tell him fantasy.
That's one of their new songs, Mike.
Is it?
It's actually Prestige. Yeah.
Is
with
it?
Total Step Brothers.
Dig that.
Yeah, I like this little breakdown here.
Thank you. green SG.
Life without a little Phrygian. Yeah, that was a good one, man.
Yeah. And there you have it. Well, dude, thank you so much for joining me.
Man, this was so much fun, dude.
Yeah, dude, this is what we do here. I saw so many comments in there of like, dude, if it wasn't for these streams, I wouldn't know about this band. So you probably turned on, you know, at least 5 or 10 new people to this band at the very least, you know?
The more the merrier, man.
That's it. Well, guys, thank you so much, moderators. You're crushing it out there. And thank you to all the regulars and all the new faces, too. You guys are the best community on YouTube. You guys know I love you, and you're always super supportive of all the guests that I have on. Be sure to give Mark a follow. His stuff is in the description. Again, he's a local guy here in Maryland. He's a great player. He does lessons. He does great gear reviews, has great interviews. So please go check him out. Let's see if we can't get him over 1,000 subscribers. And got anything else to say?
Yeah, kick me.
And kick you. And kick you.
All right, man.
All right, hang tight. Cheers, everybody. Have a good one.
See you guys.
Thank you.